They want to know why people don't go into church. It's funny because I mean, when you come to work with what we have to deal with, you know, it's awful, but working with the client, I was just raised up instantly on stress with people with disabilities.
Right.
You don't just.
Please stand as you're able. And join me in call to worship. Your responses are pretty bold in the order of worship. Lord of mystery and community, you've called us here this day
to remind us of the mission you set before us.
Help us to pay attention to the words of Jesus as he sent out his disciples on a mission of healing and compassion.
Remind us that success is not measured in the cures, but in the striving. Enable us to truly be your disciples in this world. In Jesus' name we pray.
I believe 582 is one.
Thank you. concerns with each other and lift them up to God in prayer. So let's start with good things. Do we have any joys to share today? Yeah, Jamie?
My son-in-law's brother had a aortic aneurysm, and it did significant damage to his heart now. And the doctors, 2 weeks ago on Saturday, they didn't expect him to live through the night. He's 30 years old. And by Sunday evening, they were saying it was a miracle on how well he's done. He's home now. Of course, got a long road ahead of him. But just continued prayer, but we're so thankful. He has a 1.5-year-old baby and wife. You know, so we're very thankful.
Do we have concerns to lift up today?
Yes, I have one. A dear friend of mine who is in recovery has recently relapsed. I've lost a lot of people over the years, but that's neither here nor there. Anyways, his name's Ben.
Pray for GR. I saw him yesterday. He's doing a little better, but needs our prayers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're thankful that GR's surgery went well, but he's got a long road of recovery, so we'll pray for him. Any others? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Liberating God, we are so thankful to be in your presence today. We are thankful for the good news of Libby's grandson who is responding to treatments, for Jamie's son-in-law's brother who miraculously is on the road to recovery. While we are thankful for these acts of healing, we are also thankful for the freedoms that many of us have in this country. We are thankful for all the people who have given so much of themselves and given up their lives for our freedom. God, while we are thankful for the freedoms that many of us enjoy, we are also mindful that there are many people in this country who are not fully free. We pray for change in our country, in our systems, in our policies, so that everyone, regardless of ethnicity, skin color, religious background, age, that everyone has the opportunity for a free and full life. We also lift up to you all those who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit today. We lift up to you Franklin, who is in the NICU, and we ask for your healing touch to be upon his body. We pray for Chris's friend. God, you know the depths that he is dealing with, the depths of addiction. And God, we ask for your healing in his life as well. And may he find his way back to recovery. We pray for all those today who are feeling lonely and isolated, those who are in the hospitals and in the nursing homes who are feeling alone, those who are without family and loved ones. God, we just lift up to you all those who are suffering. May they know that they are not walking this life alone. Give them assurance of your presence with them and your love that welcomes them as a child of God. Help us to follow you in your mission of love and justice in this world, even when others don't accept it. We'll give you all the thanks and all the praise, for you are faithful to hear our prayers. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Now it is time for our children's message. So, Alice, do you want to come over and join me for our time together? Have you ever experienced a time when someone wouldn't play with you or they wouldn't share with you? Have you ever experienced something like that? Yeah. How did it make you feel?
Sad, yeah.
Yeah, it's sad when people don't want to either sit by us or play with us. Or share something with us when we ask them to, and they say no.
It makes us feel sad sometimes.
There we go. So yesterday, since Tessa's not here today,
tell the story.
So yesterday, Dominic, her little 2-year-old brother, wanted to play with her, and Tessa had set up this little office tea party with food and everything, and Dominic came in and wanted to play, and he just like took all the food and threw it. Tessa got upset, and she didn't want to play with him anymore, and she told him, you can't play with me, and so she went took all the stuff and put it into her room. So we're working on that, but he got really sad. He's 2 years old, and he knows what it feels like when someone doesn't want to play, and so he got really sad and started crying. Well, in our story for today, Jesus has been traveling all over Galilee. He's been going to village to village. He's been healing people. He's been preaching and talking about God's love. And he finally comes home to his hometown, Nazareth. And at first, people are like, wow, he's talking about really a lot of stuff that has a lot of wisdom. And he's doing a lot of powerful things. But then they were like, wait a minute, who is this guy? We remember this guy when he was a kid. He's just a carpenter. He's Mary's son. Who is he to come in here, come back home, and to claim that he has all this power? And so they begin to turn on him, and they reject him. Now, Jesus isn't a 2-year-old like Dominic, so he probably didn't cry like Dominic, but he was affected by that. He was kind of like, wow, you guys aren't even going to be respecting, and you're not going to receive God's love that I'm trying to share with you. And so then he sends out his disciples out into other villages, and he says, you know what, not everybody's going to like you. Not everybody's going to accept what you're doing in God's name, and not everybody's going to accept God's love, but I want you to go out and do it anyway. So God is calling us to do kind things, to share God's love, even when people don't accept it and don't want it. Some people get kind of really angry when we share God's love because it requires us to forgive other people when they hurt us. It requires us to not repay violence with violence, so not if someone's mean to us, not be mean back. It requires us to be kind, even when someone says
mean things to us. And so some people just don't want to do those things, and so they don't accept what we're trying to share with them about God's love. But God wants us to do it anyway. So we're going to pray now, and I'm going to repeat after me if you want to. And you guys are welcome to repeat after me as well. Dear God, thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for loving us.
Even when we don't always love you back.
Help us to love as you do.
Help us to love as you do.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. All right.
Hear the scripture reading from Mark 6, 1 through 13. He left that place and came down to his hometown, and the disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, Joseph, Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters and brothers here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick men and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12, and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals, and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you, and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the word of God for all who will receive it. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us today. Breathe on us the breath of life. Amen. When I was in the fifth grade, a boy that I liked asked me to be his girlfriend. Now, in the fifth grade, being boyfriend and girlfriend meant that the boyfriend pushed the girlfriend on the swings during recess. It was a big deal. Now, I was very excited to have a boyfriend, even though I really had no idea what it meant to have a boyfriend at that age. But even though I didn't really know what it meant to have a boyfriend, I did know what it felt like to be rejected when he broke up with me. I knew that it hurt, even in the fifth grade. And that was my first experience that I remember of being rejected, and I knew that I did not want to experience it again. Jesus experiences rejection when he goes home. He has traveled all over Galilee, going from village to village, healing those who are sick, casting out unclean spirits, stilling the wind and waves on the Sea of Galilee, healing a woman who has hemorrhaged for 12 years, and raising a young girl from death. Now, he comes back to his hometown, Nazareth, and I'm not quite sure what he expects when he comes home, but maybe he expects people to react like people in the other villages that he's visited. People who come out in droves to hear Jesus teach and preach because they have heard all the amazing things that he has done. Maybe he expects them to
come to him and ask for healing because they have some faith that he can heal them. He's been gone for some time, so he probably expects his family to be excited when he returns. Maybe he expects them to come out with a big hug and even have a big meal. Maybe they do. We're not really told how they receive him when he first comes home. I'm sure his mother is very happy to see him. So we don't really know how his family reacted when they first see him. But we do know that at first, the hometown folks and maybe some of the family members are astounded at him as he teaches in the synagogue. They wonder how he can do these deeds of power. But then their amazement quickly turns to criticism. Isn't this the same boy we watched grow up? Isn't this the same boy who we saw running around with kids and chasing chickens? Isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary? Then notice they don't mention Joseph. It could be that Joseph has died by this point, or they could be referring to the scandal of Jesus' birth, since Mary was pregnant before she married Joseph. So another guy could be Jesus' father. So who is this boy, this carpenter, the son of scandal, to come back home and claim he has all his power? Who does he think he is? There might also have been some resentment toward Jesus from his family in that he's not doing what the firstborn is expected to do. At this time, the firstborn is supposed to stay at home, you know, do the family trade, carry that on, and care for his family. But Jesus leaves. He abandons his role as the firstborn to travel the countryside, claiming to do God's works. I imagine his siblings, aunts, uncles, cousins, looking at him with arms crossed, saying, he's claiming to do these wonderful deeds, and he can't even stay home and take care of his family. Now, many of us here today, at some point in our lives, have faced rejection. Maybe not as much as Jesus does in his hometown, but we face it. And as we get older, we have more opportunities to face rejection. We are rejected from health insurance companies when they refuse to cover a procedure that they deem not medically necessary, even though it is necessary. We are rejected from jobs when we get laid off. We receive rejection in a letter or email that begins with the polite address, "We regret to inform you," followed by a statement of rejection that our application for a job or college or loan has been rejected. Many of us have experienced rejection from friends when they turn their back on us, or romantic partners when they break the relationship with us. We have experienced rejection in social settings when we get the strong message that we are not welcome. We experience all kinds of rejection, and it hurts. Not just emotionally, but it actually hurts physically. Guy Winch, a licensed psychologist and author of a book about rejection, wrote an article about this. In the article, he states, MRI studies show that the same areas of the brain become activated when we experience rejection as when we experience physical pain. So the same areas of the brain that are activated when we experience physical pain are the same areas of the brain that are activated when we face rejection. Rejection hurts. It hurts us emotionally, physically, psychologically, neurologically. When we are rejected, it can cause us to think that there is something wrong with us. We can feel like failures. And it deflates our self-esteem and leads us down the spiraling of questioning our self-worth. Especially in our relationships. When we experience rejection by someone we trust, someone we love, someone in our family, it hurts deeply, the core of who we are. Jesus experiences this rejection from his family and from the people he grew up with. And then he sends his disciples out in mission to receive the same rejection. They will meet people who will reject them in the ministry of Jesus that they are doing. I don't know about you, but I don't want to sign up for rejection. When someone sends out a rallying call for us to follow them and join them, if rejection's top of the list, I don't want to sign up. But as Jesus shows his disciples and us again and again, following Jesus isn't all sunshine and rainbows. When we do God's work, we will face rejection and resistance for doing it. When we speak the truth, some people will rally against us because that truth challenges their established thoughts, behaviors, and rules. When we proclaim our allegiance to Jesus instead of a flag, some people will verbally attack us and call us disrespectful. When we advocate for people who still don't experience full freedom in our country, people will campaign against us because their rights and power over others are being threatened. Following Jesus is risky. We take the risk of rejection and resistance when we do God's work of truth, love, and justice. But we never take the risk first. God does. God takes the risk first by creating humans with the choice to either accept God's love or reject it. God takes the risk first by making a covenant with people who end up betraying that covenant time and again. God takes the risk first by becoming human in the person of Jesus. Jesus takes the risk first by doing God's work of healing, confronting unclean spirits and systems, bringing life and hope out of destruction. Jesus goes to Jerusalem knowing that he is risking his life by teaching and proclaiming God's kingdom that is in direct opposition to the way the Roman Empire works. He faces rejection by some of the leaders of his religion, by the crowd who calls for his conviction, by the soldiers who mock him and beat him, and the people who deride him as he hangs on a cross. His life, ministry, and all the deeds of power that he has done seem to end in failure as he is executed. It is risky to follow Jesus in living into and out of God's love for the world. Last week we talked about vulnerability being necessary to live wholeheartedly. Today we find that vulnerability is necessary for receiving and sharing God's love in the world as we are vulnerable in taking the risk of rejection. A friend of mine went through a divorce when her two children were in their early teenage years. After the divorce, her ex-husband manipulated their children and turned their children against her. He fed them all kinds of lies about their mother, and they believed them. As a result, their relationship with their mother suffered, and her teenage son, refused to have anything to do with her. He wouldn't accept her calls. He wouldn't come to visit her. He had no communication with her. And this went on for 5 years. Now, as you can imagine, she was devastated. She felt like her son had died. But she told me that she had to learn to trust during that time of rejection. And she had to move on with her life in a sense, to build a life in the midst of the rejection while deeply loving her son. Eventually, sometime after her son graduated from high school, he began to see how his father had manipulated him and his sister. And he began to see and believe the truth about who his mother really was. He He welcomed her back into his life, and they began to rebuild their relationship. But it took 5 years to get there. When we love, we take a risk. But it is a risk worth taking. Because even though we will be met with rejection, we will also be met with hospitality, with people who welcome us, accept us, and receive of the love of God that we are sharing. Taking a risk to love as God does, is hard and painful at times. But God goes first. God always does.
We have the opportunity now to respond to God's gift of grace by the giving of our tithes and offerings. If you brought your offering today, you can drop it off in the offering plate on the table on your way out, right there. You can also place your fuel offering in the can on the table. Our fuel offering provides snacks for children in need here at Kingston Springs Elementary. If you're worshiping online, you can send a check in the mail to our church at 368 North Main Street, Kingston Springs, or give online at ksumc.org. Let's pray over the offering. Gracious God, we thank you for the love that you freely give us. Help us to respond to your love by giving our time, talent, and resources. As we give back to you what you've so generously given to us, may others be open to receive your life-giving love. In Jesus' name we pray.
I invite you to join me in the prayer of confession, and it is printed in bold in your order of worship. God, we hear in the gospel message that Jesus was questioned and rejected by his own hometown friends and relatives. And we wonder how he was able to continue in ministry with such a lack of support. We want to enter our endeavors with full support and acclamation.
afraid of the derision of others. Place your trust in God's call and guidance. Know that the Lord is with you always, even to the ends of the earth. Amen. As we receive this bread and cup today, we are met with the one who takes the risk in becoming one of us, knowing that we might reject the love that God is offering. So I invite you now to join with me in a liturgy for Holy Communion, and your responses are printed on page 15 of the hymnal, and if you're worshiping online, it is printed in bold on your order of worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away, our love failed. When we rejected you, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us in captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ made whole by his love. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
salvation given to you. Take and drink. Our closing prayer, our prayer after receiving communion, will be our commission and benediction. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others, even in the face of rejection. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, in the name of God our Redeemer, Creator and Sustainer. Amen. And now I invite you to stand as we sing our benediction song. The words are printed in your order of worship.